Welcome to the video news of the week. A Stop the Towers power line meeting was held last Friday, January 28th, in the Colebrook Elementary School cafeteria, titled Landowners, You Are Not Alone. It was a gathering for landholders and residents who are opposed to the Northern Pass transmission line, which is proposed to cut through northern New Hampshire. Sponsored by the Powerline Education Fund of Concerned Citizens, last week's meeting saw a host of speakers address primarily land issues and the impact the proposed line would have on the property values in the affected towns.
This whole project is a current and present threat to marketability and value for the marketplace here, right now, today. Most towns up here have a warrant article that will be on the warrant this year asking you if you are in favor of this project or against this project. The Stewartstown selectmen privately are opposed to it. Publicly, until the town votes, they will not come out in favor or against it. And I think most of your boards are going to be that way.
There will be people who are making decisions that will affect our lives. So if something is going in front of the legislature or the committee to then bring before the full house, we have to pay attention and we have to be aware of the fact that that's very important.
These towers were going to put my development at Owl's Nest, which is homes and condominiums and golfers, we're going to put us out of business. Not marginally out of business, but we would be done. We would fold up, we would go away, we would take the keys and go down to the bank and drop the keys on the bank's desk and say thank you, we gave it our best shot. But I started to hear about what you all were doing, and that you were having meetings and you were having get-togethers and you were talking about this thing and you weren't laying down on it. The more I heard about that, the more I decided, geez, I better get involved. I better find out if there is a basis upon which you could fight this thing and beat them. And let me tell you, when I saw that sign about kiss my ass, I pretty much made up my mind by then.
You're part of the North Country now.
So here's your problem. You're going to let people on your land. You don't really know who they're working for, and maybe they're working for two masters. They aren't working for you, and it's your land. And you don't have to let them on until somebody hands you a court order. And that won't happen for a long, long time. Maybe 2, maybe 3 years before they could be in a position to require it.
Hi, I'm Larry Rappaport. I'm your representative, COAS District 1.
I've gotten over 200 emails, and 197 of them are opposed. And only 3 of them are for it. For people that say you can't win, that's not true. You certainly can win. And it's only by fighting them that you will win. So please.
This place was packed. It's mobbed. And I'm amazed by the depth of the opposition to the project.
I notice you're wearing an orange lapel. Is that officially we can say that you are against this?
Yes, I don't see any benefit to the North Country whatsoever, and I see significant disadvantages to it.
In other Northern Pass news, next Tuesday, February 8th, many opponents of the proposed transmission line are expected to board a bus to Concord to take part in the public hearings regarding House Bill 302. The bus will leave the Colebrook Municipal parking lot behind Ducre's Sporting Goods store in Colebrook at 8:30 a.m. The public hearing is to be held at the Legislative Office Building and will discuss whether to allow large-scale energy projects to qualify for the state's renewable energy certificates. Currently, the Northern Pass project does not qualify as a renewable power project, and the bill, if it passes, would change that status. Organizers of the protest say the bill rewrites a law so that the Northern Pass project would qualify as a renewable energy project under state law.
The 4th annual Great North Woods Talent Showcase took place in St. Francis Hall in Groveton last Saturday night. A wide variety of local performers turned out for the event, organized and hosted by the Knights of Columbus. The event was dedicated in memory of the late Carolyn Brooks.
Your smile is like a breath of spring, your voice is soft like summer rain, and I cannot compete with you, Joe. talks about you in his sleep. There's nothing I can do but keep from crying when he calls your name. No name.
Quebec history passed under the gavel in Lennoxville, Quebec this past week. On Saturday, January 29th, the contents of St-Antoine's Church on the corners of Queen and College Streets were sold off as a historic church closed. Handling the auction was Ross and Scott Bennett, auctioneers, and our correspondent Corey Bellum was there. Martin Prue, priest for St-Antoine's, is shown here thanking auctioneer Ross Bennett at the completion of the auction as a pair stood in front of a large wall hanging in the church. Old oak pews, church statues, ivory stands, and much more was sold. Close to 300 people attended the auction. The proceeds from the auction will help maintain St. Anton Cemetery.
Patty Moulton of Pittsburgh took this stunning photo of an eagle landing on a tree last Friday morning in the Hall Stream area. Patty says this eagle was one of two which spends most of the day in the area. While most of the country has been hit by severe storm conditions, things are relatively quiet in our region. On Friday, expect partly cloudy skies with a high of 18 and a low of 9. Saturday brings a few snow showers and warmer temperatures. Sunday clears up a bit with a high of 25 and a low of 16. Chronicle reporter Liz Carney was present for Pittsburgh's last home game on Tuesday night.
Yeah.
graduating seniors were recognized during the game, including Felicia Carney, Matthew Geralds, Matthew Ormsby, Logan Chase, Evan Kelsey, and Brooke Judd. Thank you for watching the Video News of the Week.